just going to briefly kind of tantalize you here with some of the goodies, what you can get if you do sign up for Ancestry. And then we're going to talk about how to get from where you are, which I understand from Liz is pretty much interest, but not yet been able to start down that path that's going to lead to your ancestors. I hope that's the majority. All right, so I'm beginning here with, this is my maternal grandmother, Martha Dawson McMillan, and the purpose here is to show you the kinds of things that you can get and what you can do with them. When I first started with genealogy 30 years ago, one of the biggest questions around was, how do you organize all the stuff? Once you really get going on your family history and you get into the various databases that are available, you get an awful lot of stuff. And we all started out with a little three-ring binder, and oh, well, that turned out not to be quite enough, so we got a wider three. And you know, the three-ring binders can get to be about that wide, and then we needed another, and that, and then finally my husband built a whole insert for our closet in the guest room, and it was it's just solid, and I don't use them at all anymore. Everything is on Ancestry. If I can get it on top of my scanner, for example, my father's war medals, they'll sit there. Yeah, there'll be a little bit of light coming in. I use the blanket. If I can get it on the top of the scanner, it's going on to Ancestry. Because when I die, my stuff, all those notebooks, the kids are just going to have a fit, I know, and especially since I haven't been using them, they're out the window. But what if somebody gets interested when they get, they need to be a little bit older, right? Younger kids are just a little bit self-absorbed, and they've got families to raise, and we understand that. But then they hit a certain age, and they get interested, and they want to know. If it's all already gone to the trash with the cleaning out that inevitably is going to come at the end of our lives, then what about all the hours and the years that we poured into what we collected? It's all gone, unless you put it on Ancestry. And if you put it on Ancestry, believe me, it's going to be there. It's going to be there. So I have, I just want to hit a couple of the highlights. This is what is called a fax page, where sometimes people call it the timeline page. And for some reason, it's not wanting to move. Here we go. Okay, so here's my grandmother's life in about 20 lines, okay? But then I can go over to the gallery, which you have two galleries. For those of you who have Ancestry, I know a lot of people don't realize you have two galleries. You have an individual gallery for every individual person in your tree. I have 3,000 people in my tree. That may sound like a lot to many of you. It isn't really. When you get out there, there are people with a ridiculous number of people, and you know they haven't done the research. And tonight I'm hoping to convince you to do the research so that you wind up with real genealogy. So, in my grandmother's gallery, I have all of these documents that apply to her, a selection of pictures. I have four pages of just from my grandmother from when she is very, very young here, hardly a year old, up until shortly before she passed away. She was in her 90s. And so here is her life that I want to pass on to her descendants, to my descendants, and that they will come to know this woman that I love dearly. And they'll come to know her as something more than just what you can and must start with. What the Brits call hatched, matched, dispatched. Born, married, died. We know that our lives are a lot more than just that, so much more. And if you leave this behind, as far as you want to go with your passion, you will be leaving something behind for those that aren't even born yet, aren't even a twinkle in Grandpa's eye. Yeah. So I'm going to move to a PowerPoint presentation, and I want to invite you to do three things. Number one, when I'm finished, if you want it, I'm giving it to the library, and all you have to do is bring a flash drive the library and they will transfer it to your flash drive, and then you'll have it on your computer. So you don't need to sit there as I go through 20 some odd slides on the PowerPoint and try and take notes. Try to follow the conversation, and let me know if you have questions or concerns. Don't worry about trying to write everything down. Yes.
You said there was two pages under the gallery. What was the other page, or was it?
No, I said I was going to show you. Yeah. Well, it's basically the electronic version of what you have a paper sheet of.
Oh, okay.
The five generation pedigree. I mean, I could spend the whole night on ancestry, but I understood that most of you didn't have it and that we need to talk about how to get there. So, thank you. Yeah, I start talking about Grandma and I just kind of lose track. She was a wonderful, wonderful person. All right, so you are not going to be besieged with trying to take notes. You're going to try to follow along. If you have brief questions and that are not specific to your family, that would be general for everybody, how to, feel free to raise your hand and I will try and deal with that during the presentation. But I have a lot of slides to get through. I want to be sure I get through everything. And then at the end, I'll stay after. If you have family-specific questions that are of interest to you and not the rest of the room. So, I am warning you, I am the guy in the overcoat standing outside of a elementary or a middle school saying, psst, hey, you, kid, you want to see something interesting? And so I'm warning you right now, there is definitely an obsession ahead if you don't know it. This is absolutely addicting. And I don't feel guilty. I want to know, first of all, why you're here tonight. Why are you here tonight? Think about that just for a moment. Haven't you heard? Genealogy, isn't easy. It's a time eater. I can go up there at 7:30 at night and tell my husband, I've got 10 minutes, I'll be downstairs. You know, 2 hours later, he's saying, are you coming down? And so I'll go down for a little while, and then he'll go to bed, and then I'll be back on there. And I'm apt to be there until 2:30 or 3:30 in the morning. So it is a time eater. It can be expensive. There are specialty, am I blocking your view of the screen? Okay. There are specialty genealogy. Can I move a little bit? Oh. Thanks. There are specialty genealogy cruises by most of the cruise lines, and they started about $10,000 a piece. That does not count the actual research when you get to whatever your city of interest is. That's extra, of course. So you can spend a lot of money in genealogy. And it's addictive, as I've already warned you. I've told you that. So with those thoughts in mind, you probably don't want to spend $10,000 to go on a genealogy cruise. It's a lot more fun to do it on your own and sit till 2:30, 3:30 in the morning. But I want you to know why I'm here tonight, and I know it's why, at least to some extent, you are here tonight. It's because we are the chosen. In each family, there is one who seems called to find the ancestors, to put flesh on their bones and make them live again, to tell the family story, and to feel that somehow they know and they approve. Doing genealogy is not a cold gathering of facts, but instead breathing life into all who have gone before. We are the storytellers of the tribe. That's why you're here tonight on some level, and that's why I'm here tonight. We are ancient. We are multicultural. We are universal. We are the storytellers of the tribe. And so I want to take about 5 minutes out of the presentation and tell you my story, why I got dragged into this crazy obsession. I didn't know it, but I became the storyteller of my tribe when I was 6 years and 10 days old. came home from elementary school with my brother to see a lot of cars around the house that I didn't know, and a lot of people that I didn't know what the heck they were doing there. And one of them took us by the hand, my brother, 2 years older, and I, into the kitchen and told us that our father would not be coming home. He had been killed in the crash of his training plane. He was getting ready to go to the Korean conflict. And he had gone to be with God. That day, I lost my father, and I didn't know it yet, but I lost my whole Dingwall family. Dingwall is my maiden name. Because after we got the Air Force sent us with his body to, this happened in Alabama, and we got back to Milwaukee, where he was from, and his side of the family was from, and his mother, who was divorced from his father, met with my mother and said, I want to see my son. And my mother said, no, you may not. It wasn't just a plane crash. He bailed out. This was 6 months before the introduction of the ejection seat. He was 500 feet from the ground. His parachute never opened. And the mortuary officer told my mother, do not ask to see your husband. You need to remember him as he was. And my mother, probably one of the most stubborn women I've ever met in my life, said, no one will see him. If that's what you're telling me, no one will see. And my mother got into an argument with my dad's mother because she wanted to see her son one last time. And she said, my mother said, absolutely not. And my mother had the law behind her, even though his mother had had him longer than she'd had him, and she brought that up. So big family argument. And I didn't see the paternal side of my family for 25 years over this issue. So I missed him terribly. Every day it seemed like, and I made up all kinds of these fantasies about he's really still alive and the CIA got him to go over there and be a spy or something like this. At any rate, my 2 years older brother, and as he informed me on an almost daily basis, wiser brother, told me, you know, it's okay, we don't, you know, we're doing fine. And did you know there is a city in Scotland named Dingwall? No, I didn't know it. And at first I believed it, like you believe in Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and the Tooth Fairy. I believed it. And it helped me when I heard things at school, that kids that call me things like dingbat, dingus, dingy, all of those kinds of hurtful things. And I would say, yeah, well, I've got a city in Scotland named after my family. What have you got? And then I grew up, and yeah, okay, Santa Claus is your parents, and the Easter Bunny, yeah, okay. And I, from the very first day of school, for me, kindergarten, I knew I wanted to be a school teacher. I came home and told my parents, I'm going to be a school teacher when I grow up. And, yeah, right, sure you are. And as I went through the grades, I'm going to teach elementary school. Oh, no, I'm going to teach junior high. Oh, no, I'm going to teach high school. And I was so excited to get to teach. I went through college in 3 years. You can do it if you go to summer school year round. And I stood up in front of my first high school group of students when I was 20 years old. And I had students in that class who were on the extended graduation plan. Yeah, that were 19 and 20. Yeah, okay. So I learned very quickly, one of the things about teaching teenagers is you don't want to turn your back on the room for very long at all. I'm an English teacher, and when we were getting ready to teach Macbeth, I had one of those roll-up maps. You probably had them in your classroom, and I would just walk over to the chalkboard, and I would pull, it was England and Scotland, and I'd pull it down. I'm watching the class. Nothing's going on. Boy, they're not getting anything by me. And I would just reach up, just very quickly, I'd do it in less than 2 seconds, find Inverness on the Scottish map, point to it, and say, this is where we're going to be talking about. This is Inverness. And I did this for 15 years until on the 15th time I did it, and that was the only time of the year I used that map, I glanced up to get situated with Inverness, and good Lord, right to the northwest of Inverness, it says, Easter Bunny, but I got a town in Scotland named after me. Couldn't believe it. Well, vice versa, right? I got named after a town in Scotland. Ran home, told my husband, Jim, this is Jim, who is a prince. Told him, I said, there's a town in Scotland named Dingwall, and he says, I'll take you there someday. And I said, all right, all right. Took me a long time to make up my mind on that one. And so someday turned into 10 years, but we got there. And I was prepared. I had torn a page out of my baby book. I probably didn't tear it. I didn't tear it.
I made a copy.
Anyway, we get to this quaint little 12th century town in Dingwall. I mean, it looks like something out of Brigadoon, if any of you have ever seen Brigadoon. Anything old, ancient, Scottish, that's what it looked like. And we walk into the family records office, and this dour Scottish lady looks up at me and says, may I help you? And I said, oh yes, I'm here to find my family. And she says, very good. Let's start with some names and some dates. And I said, oh, I got it all written down. And I hand her this. And she looks up at me and she says, darling, where are the dates? Darling, are you sure that all this information is correct? It's only across the top, the Dingwalls? And I said, I don't have any dates, but I know they're from here. She says, I cannot help you. This next line may not be true. Maybe my husband remembers, I do not. In my mind, I stamp my foot, and that's just so out of character for me. I said, I am Patricia Dingwall. Like, oh, okay, then let's just go open the vaults, and here will come flowing all of these records. And she said, darling, you see the cemetery across the street? I said, yeah, we've been over there. She said, more than half of them buried there, Dingwall. She said, this town goes back to the 12th century. I need dates. I need more names than Dingwall. I need to know who the Dingwalls married with. And I said, well, I think it's Flora Mae Stewart. And she said, you got dates on her? I said, no. You got parents on her? No. Do you know who left this town and went to the United States? I said, well, they didn't go to the United States, they went to Canada, and then it's kind of, and then they came down to the United States. She says, you know nothing? I know nothing. We meekly walked out, and I said, I got to get home and get in a genealogy class. That's how I became the storyteller of my tribe. I came back to this issue that my mother had done when I was born. She should have known. I assume she was there. And it's a mess. Okay? This is these red circles that you see up here now are the result of my having researched the Dingwalls, my Dingwalls, for over 10 years to get to these circles and to be confident I could replace them with reality. She did a number of things that were wrong. That I want you all not to do. She listed every married name with every woman. Ladies, they take it away from us as it is. What we're entitled to is our last name to stick with us to the grave, whether we're using it or not, that it should still be there. So when you start filling out your family group sheet that I'll talk about in just a minute, you will use women's last names that they were born with. If you don't know it, you will leave it blank. You will not write something like unknown. When you go to the computer, if you type in a woman and you put unknown, or a man, either one, doesn't matter, either one, and you put unknown for the last name, you are telling these incredibly powerful Ancestry.com computers to look for somebody named Julia Unknown. Gosh, we can't find her in any of the censuses. A lot of people put up LNU. That stands for last name unknown. So when you're researching, you're going, gosh, I must have a lot of these ancestors. I don't know this LNU line. That's what it stands for. And again, you are completely blocking yourself off from the vast resources of all the data that Ancestry has gathered, and it's a lot. So she's listed last names here all over the place. She has right here combined a man from the earlier generation, one more back, with the first name of the woman who does belong there, but she's not a Stuart. Darn it. Royal lines. Don't have them. Down here, my father's grandmother, she's got this Mary Dolan written up. I don't have any Dolans. It took me a lot of time figuring that out. Put a lot of time searching into Stuarts and Dolans, and they just aren't there. When you write something down, be sure that it's got a pretty good chance of being right. And more importantly, most importantly, look at the bottom. Let me go back. This is what I took. This is what I took to the lady in Dingwall, Scotland. Look at that. Notes and authorities. In other words, how do you know what you know? Blank as can be. Blank as can be. She wrote down nothing. On Ancestry, you have the opportunity to document absolutely every single aspect of your ancestors' lives because they've got such vast databases. I don't want you to start, for those of you who haven't already, I don't want you to start on Ancestry. I want you to start with this. This is called a family group sheet. Let me get up to it. This is a family group sheet. And the very last column that asks for additional information, that you just that's a misnomer. I couldn't find one that said what I wanted it to say. Document, documentation, source, whatever. How do you know what you know? And I see some of you starting to write on it. I hope you're writing with a pencil. Because you're going to find that what you think you know isn't always right. And if the only way you know something is because, well, I'm in that family, you're talking about my dad, for heaven's sakes. Of course I know where he was born. Well, I didn't happen to mention, did I, that when we were getting ready to go to Scotland, we had to get our first passports. I'd never applied for a passport, had never been out of the country. And they want to know personal stuff, like where, you know, who's your mom, who's your dad, where was your mom born, where was your dad born. And I guess for the first time in my life, and I was over 50, I read my own birth certificate. How many of you have actually read your birth certificate? Oh, well, that's good. You're way ahead of me. I hadn't, you know, glanced at it, sure. Check out the birth. Yeah, that's the birthday. Make sure you get it on the calendar so the family knows it's coming up and you get taken out for dinner. At any rate, I had never read my birth certificate, and it asks, who's your father? Has his name. Where's he born? Oh, I know that. He was born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And I looked at it and couldn't believe it because it said Minnesota. Oh, what good's a birth certificate, especially if you have to pay for it and it's got wrong information on it? And I thought, birth certificate. I got on the phone and called my mother down in Texas, and I said, Mother, where was Daddy born? She said, Milwaukee. I said, well, that's what I thought. Why doesn't my birth certificate say he was born in Milwaukee? It says Minnesota. Dead silence. She's thinking. She does not have Alzheimer's yet. Finally, she says, you know what? I remember now, he was born in Minnesota, that's right. He was due at the end of April, and they went to Minnesota to visit some cousins, and she went into labor early, and he was born in Minnesota. So if you don't have a document that says it, it's called an FS, family source. You don't know it until you've seen it on paper, on a document. Preferably on a document that was created at the time of the event. So let's say by the time you get to your grandparents, you are talking about before 1908 when registration across this country kind of came into being, and they didn't have birth certificates. lot of places, the bigger cities tended to. Rural, born out on the farm, right? Yeah, get out the family Bible and write it in the Bible, honey. And that's great if you can find the Bible, but which of the 12 kids got the Bible, and did they take good care of it, and was anybody going to willing to let you have it, or at least see it, or get a picture of it, because that is considered to be a valid source, especially if the dates in it do not predate the date that it was printed. So, you need documentation. And then you are ready to start filling out your chart. Not yet on Ancestry until you get through your great-grandparents. I would like all of you to consider this to be homework, even if I never see you again. But consider it to be homework. If I see you on the street, I might ask. I might give you extra credit or bonus points if you say, not only, hey, Trisha, look at this. Got it with me right here. Here you go. It's all filled out. And look at that documentation column. It's got BC for birth certificate, ML or for marriage license, or MC for marriage certificate. They aren't the same, and they don't have the same information. And don't think because you have the marriage certificate that you have everything there is to get out of that marriage. Because very often the marriage certificate just says they got married on this date by this minister, and here are the witnesses. If you can get the license they had to fill out, not every jurisdiction kept them, unfortunately, some did. Now you've got a treasure chest of birth dates and parent names and parent birthplaces. At any rate, MC for marriage license, ML for marriage license, DC for death certificate. That's when you've got everything filled out in that final column. If you don't have anything in paper, it has to be FS and for family source. And you are trying constantly, it is your goal in life to get rid of all your FSs and replace them with, maybe it's the 1900 census. Maybe, you know, there are, maybe it's a will, maybe it's probate, maybe it's church record. Lots of things can go in that final column, but you need something there. You start with FS sometimes because that's all you've got. How many of you here have at least one person in the generation above you? Raise your hand. One?
Still alive.
Right, that's still alive. That's what I mean. You're the only one in the room. You need to get in touch. It's time to get reacquainted in the family unit if you haven't been lately. You want to get reacquainted with that person. Oh, bless your heart. How's your mind? That's oh, wow. You need to start asking her certain questions. Yeah. When was Aunt Sally born? Do you remember anything about any marriages? Or I mean, there's, you can go online and you can find genealogical questions to ask your older relatives, and they're wonderful. And just even conversation starters, if they seem reluctant, some people are. There are a lot of family secrets out there. A lot of them we find out, and some of them we don't. And we're not going to talk about DNA tonight, but that's another whole can that you can open up. But so you start with the known. What do you know? How do you know it? And then you work your way to the unknown, making the unknown become the known. You never, never, never skip over a generation. If you say, well, I don't know here who the great grandparents are, but I know, because I've seen it online, that the second great grandparents are over here. No, you must prove each generation before you have any validity for going to the one farther back, because what you saw online is probably what I lovingly call garbage genealogy. I don't know about this kid here. I always do that with a pointer. Point to the screen instead of this. Okay, I don't know about this little kid over here. We need some investigation, okay? Can everybody see this last little child here? Questions need to be answered about that child. And there are indeed, as I said, family secrets, and sometimes people don't want to answer questions. So then you back off and you ask, well, how much did a loaf of bread cost, or something like that, just to get them talking again. The next thing you need to do is make a list of alternate spellings for your surname. I don't know how many people I've heard say. Our last name is Allen. It's A-L-L-A-N. And anybody else that spells it any other way, they're not talking about our people. You've just lopped off probably 80% of your real blood ancestors, because spelling of names was not formalized until relatively recently. And I suppose in some families still, yes, I had an email earlier this week that said, because the Bozeman, or the Gallatin County, remember, Belgrade's in the same county, right? So y'all come on over to our meetings. We meet 7 times a year. And we have a huge database online. It's approaching 300,000 entries just for vital records in Gallatin County. So I had this letter from this man who wanted me to do some lookups for him, that he had found our online index. And he said, oh, and by the way, you have our last name spelled wrong. He says, it ends in Shire, S-H, we changed the spelling. It ends in S-H-I-E-R, and you have S-H-I-R-E. Like, we should know better. And I said, you know what? We're indexing the newspaper. Whatever it says in the newspaper is what we have to go on. We have no way of knowing that your family in the previous generation decided S-H-I-E-R sounds more refined. But I got him as Obis. And if you have roots in Gallatin County, and if you have not been to Gallatin County Genealogical Society on Google, you need to go there. Our databases are amazing. When I said 300,000, that's just the vital records out of the Bozeman Daily Chronicle. We have funeral home records. We have voter registration records for the whole county. If your people are here, I bet you're going to find them online at our website. And do come to our meetings. We'd love to have you. Oh, keep doing that. Okay, so you're going to make a list of all the different. Oh, I want to go back and specifically talk about one. You can probably understand how from the name Macmillan, you're going to get these other kinds of spellings. This one probably seems really weird. And how would you even ever look for a McWilliams in an index? All indexes are genealogists' best friends. How would you ever even go there looking for your family? How could this happen? There are all these layers between the real information and it coming down to you. And one of those layers of information is bad handwriting. So in the 1950 census, if I thought of it, I would have made yet another slide, but I knew I was already making too many slides. I would have copied the 1850 census for my Macmillan family in Wisconsin. And I would show you, okay, I wouldn't have told you that I'm researching Macmillans. I would have said, this is my great-grandfather. What is this name? Handwriting like that. Look what, W. McWilliams. That's how it made it into the indexes as McWilliams. So you don't know the correct spelling for your family name. There is not such a thing. So you want to look around. And a lot of people of Irish descent and of Scottish descent dropped those prefixes when they got over here. There was a lot of sentiment against Irish people and Scottish people, and so they didn't want to be O'Malley, and so they became the Malleys. Or O'Neill, and they became the Neills. Or Macmillan, and they became the Millans. For the my Macmillans, I know the exact point and the exact reason. They have a little something to do with counterfeiting money. They didn't want to be associated with it. All right. How to write what you're going to write is very important. And I'm saying that not as an English teacher. I'm saying that as a genealogist. Although I start with Shakespeare. What's in a name? you want to use the full name always. You do not want to use initials, even if your great uncle Charlie had a middle name that he absolutely hated and never used and always used the initial. You wheedle it out of him or find some other way, get the name if you possibly can, and you write down what that middle name is. You never use initials unless that's the only thing you know. Realize that middle names were often used as first names. I still have Livingston Charles McMillan, or is he Charles Livingston McMillan? His death certificate and his tombstone don't even agree. I've got about 30 articles in the paper from this guy, and one week he's Livingston Charles, or LC, and the next week he's Charles Livingston. So be aware of that. Middle names are important. I had a lot of resentment against people who don't use their first name. What's wrong with you? And then I realized that our younger son, William Scott Thompson, has always been called Scott. Always. I never called him William. I'm not sure why that made it there to the birth certificate, but it did. So be aware of that. As I've already said, never write blank. Leave it blank. Never write unknown. Never write LNU. If you have something that could be confusing, like the marriage of cousins, happened a lot, then you want to underline a name that you are. You want to underline a name that you are calling attention to and saying, yes, I know you think that I'm a dummy and I listed her with her husband's last name. You're saying with that underline, no, her maiden name is McMillan, as it was, indeed. If you are putting down nicknames, put those in quotation marks. They are important. They really are. In finding people, and particularly when you get into a newspaper search, they're more often going to be in there by their nickname than their first name or initials. When you are writing something out, you always want to indicate if you're going to give her last name that she goes by, you want to, if you at all can, give her her maiden name. Put it in parentheses. Parentheses are supposed to mean, for people who know what they're doing in genealogy, and that includes all of you, it means it's in parentheses, not quotation marks, it means it's her maiden name. The other way to indicate that, of course, is with NEE, me, born as. It's right. Tried to change the wrong thing. Another part of writing it right has to do with the actual location. You want to write down everything you can about the various jurisdictions where records were kept. That means you don't just go city-state. You don't say Belgrade, Montana. You say Belgrade, Gallatin County, Montana, and you don't use postal abbreviations. You write it out. You're writing for the world. I had a friend a few years ago who was missing a mail order, and she called up the company, and she had the gal, she said, oh, we sent that out to you. And Jackie, it was Jackie. And Jackie said, read me what you have down for my address. And the gal read it out, and she said, well, let's see. She gave her the street address, and then she says, Montana, M.A. That's Massachusetts. She went through the whole list of all the M states just about. And any of those really could be Montana, right? And if you don't live here, you don't necessarily know. And you're writing for the future, and you're writing for relatives that you have that live abroad as well, cousins, other branches of the family. You write out Montana. Don't tell me about your cream. I know. Listen, my thumb sticks, and it's hard to write. So the computer's much easier. The other thing you want to write right is the date. We are not in the majority of the world in how we report our dates. We say today is, oh my gosh, what is the 19th? We say today is January 19th, 2023, and the rest of the world gets it right. And they say it's 19 January 2023. And that really is essential when you are looking at people who use numbers for months. You will get into records that will say something like, this birth occurred on 12/9/1895. Are you talking about December the 9th? Or are you talking about the 12th of September? Exactly. So write it right. In the older documents, you will definitely run up against handwriting issues. So many of them could not, for whatever reason, close the top of an A, and you won't be able to tell the difference. I've stared at records and stared. Is this a June or January? And you say, well, it's not really that important, is it? Yes, it is. It could depend on when somebody died. It could depend on knowing when somebody moved, when they were present at a particular location. It really is important. And you'll stare at these things, and you will curse somebody in the past. To get around that, they used something that may at first look a little unusual to you, J-A-N-Y. That was because the person writing it knew of the June-January problem. And, I mean, they don't want to write out January. Remember, they're writing with quill pens, a bunch of these old documents. And you got to dip it. It's a pain. At any rate, so J-N-Y came into use by a lot of clerks. So that's January. And then there is the issue of numbers, which we'll take a look at here in just a minute. You're ready to start the research cycle. You're ready to hit, yes, the trail.
I just have a question. On locations and counties like Canada, have changed their counties?
Absolutely.
So with the current now county.
Yep. Getting there, but I'll stop and I'll talk about that now. No, this is a very important issue when you're talking about locations. Jurisdictional boundaries changed throughout the years. There was a huge change in county outlines right after the Revolutionary War. Let's talk about West Virginia. Let's talk about the capital of West Virginia, Charleston. And you're looking for maybe some land records, I don't know, 1820. Where should you be looking in 1820 for Charleston, West Virginia? You should be looking in Virginia, because West Virginia didn't exist until West Virginia withdrew from the South, after the South withdrew from the Union. So anything, and that happened in 1863, so anything that happened in West Virginia that you come across a record and it's before 1863, you go, I'm not putting much faith in this. And it's really important in telling you where to look. If it's probate, really important records can be found in probate. And your person died in 1840, and they, West Virginia. No, there wasn't a West Virginia in 1840. You need to be looking at the statewide records in Virginia. So absolutely. And county records, the whole eastern part of Tennessee, you know, the long, skinny state, just chop off that piece right there. Make it a nice, even line. All that used to be North Carolina until North Carolina decided we don't really want to go to war with our own country over this. We'll let Tennessee have it. What the heck? So you find a county name from when you're looking for the record. You can go on Wikipedia, and you can put in any county's name. And the first thing just about that's going to come up is the history of the county. It'll tell you when it was formed and the parent county. They chopped land off of what other county. That's where you want to go looking if the records you're looking for are from that time period. So you need to know the time period, and you need to know the boundary changes. Jurisdiction is everything. Yeah, they didn't move the records. The records are sitting. We went up the Rhine River here just right before COVID broke out in 2020, and we went on a tour with a woman who said her grandmother lived in three different countries in her lifetime. One house. Three different countries. Yeah. So the research cycle means you are focused, and if you start on ancestry.com too soon, and by too soon I mean before you have filled this out for you, your parents, your grandparents, and your great-grandparents, four generations. If you get to ancestry before that, believe me, it would be like you're flying home from wherever, and somebody says, oh, well, hey, you wanted to learn how to fly a plane, right? captain just died. Come on up here. We're going to put you in the seat, and you land this plane. That's what ancestry, and you're just looking at everything there is to push and touch, and that's what ancestry will be. If you don't have your feet firmly on the ground for the first four generations, that you can do to the best of your ability, may not be perfect, but to the best of your ability with documentation, you will be like that person dragged up to fly the plane that just wanted to fly someday, but not under these circumstances. So, you pick a single goal. Let's say tonight I want to find my great-grandmother's maiden name. I don't know it. You pick, how could I find out? Well, if you have anybody living in the generation above you, you maybe have somebody to ask to at least get an idea. But that is going to be an FS. That's going to be a family source. So then you ask yourself, what other records might tell me? Marriage record might be really good because you know her married name. And so if you can find a marriage license or even a marriage certificate in that case, it's going to have her maiden name, most likely. Sometimes record keepers were very inconsiderate of future family historians. So then you find a source, you search through all those sources, it's 2:30 in the morning and you have found something. You use that. Now, how is that going to help me? Well, it's going to tell me the name of her father, and that's going to get me back a gen. And they were living in this place, and now I know another place to look. So you pick one small focused goal for the night, and or set a bedtime for yourself and say, I'm not going to go later than 2:30. You will find conflicting pieces of information. And when you do, you need to make note of it. You need to not say, oh, well, I already know. I already know the birthday, and I know that's wrong. I've got this death certificate right here, and it tells me when my grandmother was born. Grandma lived to be in her 90s. You got to ask all kinds of questions when you have a conflicting source. If it goes along with everything else you have, that's great. But if it conflicts, you got to ask yourself, why does it conflict? Well, maybe when Grandma passed away, nobody else was right there when the county was there saying, I need to fill out this information for the death certificate. And so that person just says, well, you know what? We celebrated her birthday. I think that was a couple weeks ago. I think it must have been on, I don't know, January 8th. And I have a lot of death certificates where it says, and if you read your certificates down at the bottom, it will say name of person giving information. And then hopefully below that it will say relationship to deceased. It won't always. But I had a grandfather whose death certificate I had looked at 100 times every time we went to Salt Lake, went to the library, cranked through the microfilm. I kept passing it up because that can't be the John Lynn I'm looking for because this guy's 10 years too old. But everything else was telling me it's the death certificate that's got it wrong. And then I read who gave the information. It was the floor nurse. She just said something. Now is the issue of old handwriting. Okay? This is the part of class where I would offer extra credit for anybody who can. Let's start with this one over here in the first box. Any guesses? Notice how the end of it comes way up. Okay? What does it look like it starts with? Not a CH. TH. This is Thomas. Okay. Ink was expensive, and it was hard to keep dipping your quill pen, and so abbreviations abounded. And to indicate that the writer is leaving out letters, they raise that last letter. So they're saying between the O and the S, there was some other stuff. So that tells you you've got a name here that isn't just T H. I'm not sure if that's an O or an A, and whatever. All right, context helps, and these are all out of context. Let's come down to this one. This is easy. The problem with cursive writing is that the capital S used to look exactly like a capital L. more like a capital L than a capital S. What is this phrase? Very good. State of South Carolina. This is the kind of stuff you have to deal with and look at and wonder and take to your friends and say, can you help me with this? Here you've got a small S that looks for all the world like an F. Have you seen those old things printed of the Declaration of Independence in Congress, and Congress comes down like this, the second S comes down like this? And if you look at it carefully, it's actually not like an F, which loops around this way, but it loops around that way, and that's a small S. This word is possessed. Nothing demonic. He died possessed of certain things. Here you're dealing not only with the handwriting and the difference in the letters, but with somebody who can't spell. Mississippi. That'd be Mississippi. Yeah, because they left out that inner part. And down here, we have something that my husband struggled with for, I don't know, more than 1 year. Several. Well, first of all, the context would help. This is from a census. This is a name. You need the name on the census to know you're there. Nobody will get it. I'm just going to give it to you. Oh, yeah, so you think it starts with a P, and that's what Jimmy thought for a long time. It's not a P. It's not a T. It's an F. And the crossbar of the F in old cursive used to be right there. Only it faded out because their ink was bad, you know. And that's just one of those things you have to live with. This name is, and not only that, it's misspelled. The man's name is Fields, F-I-E-L-D-S. You've got something almost indecipherable. P-H, Fikeless, my husband thought it was for years. He thought the name was Fikeless. Passed that up because he's looking for Fields. And then came back and did some cross-checking. Yeah, so you will be up against that as well. Let's see, did I skip one? Witness it, state of count of South Carolina.
One above that.
Possess,
above Carolina.
Mississippi.
Just to the right of Thomas.
The top line.
Thomas.
Yeah, and then the next one. Right.
That's why I said a couple times. Witnesseth.
Witnesseth.
In other words, the witnesses of the deeds. So witnesseth these individuals. Oh. And then they would sign their name, and that would be unreadable to you. Yeah, well, context helps. When you've read a bunch of wills and you get to the bottom and there's some other signatures and you go, okay, yeah, and there's that S, that small, this letter that looks for all the world like one of the most identifiable letters in that word. That's an F. No, it's not. It's a small S. It's a lowercase S. Witness it. That's how they wrote it. See how the loop comes around backwards, whereas a true F would come around. Thought I was kidding about 2:30 in the morning? I'm kidding. So, you want to create a chronology for each family as you go. This will help you pick out gross genealogical garbage errors, like a woman giving birth at age 5, or a man fathering the child when he had been dead for 5 years. Those kinds of things. So, you just start a basic timeline. Ancestry will do it for you down this way, as I showed you at the beginning. It'll be vertical. For some reason, it seems to me not, it doesn't quite jar you when you see it and there's something wrong here. As if you do the way we kind of think of time, we think of it as linear, even though it really isn't. Or we wouldn't keep getting older. So you write down what you know from the records. What can you prove about this family? This is my Irish family, Hanley. And I know from much later records in the United States that he's born in 1820. I know from much later records, the 1900 census in the United States, that he got married in what would have been 1842. I know that their first child, Sean, is born in Ireland. I get this from the census. I know their next child, Mary, is born in New York in 1845. Hold the phone. What else do I know, most likely? I know where to look for immigration records and ship manifest records. Sean, she's not running back and forth to have babies in different continents, okay? They moved. Mary's born in New York. They moved, and I'm lucky here. I only have 2 years to really be concerned about, 43 to 45. In 1860, I couldn't find them in 1850. Should have been able to, couldn't have. They were lost somewhere. In 1860, they are, and it's definitely the right family. They are in Iowa, and in 1870, he is without Bridget, a little old to begin the divorce. Most likely, Bridget died. I can most likely be looking to see if there's a burial or something. More importantly, on the censuses, every little mark you want to pay attention to. On the 1870 census, there's just this grid after the names and where were you born and all of that, when were you born, and it's just a grid, and some of them have little hash marks in them. Some of them are missing. For every little hash mark you find, you want to go to the top. What is this column telling me? This is the column for males eligible to vote. You say, so what? I say, so naturalization. If he's eligible to vote, and he's an immigrant, he has naturalization papers, and I can go looking for those. So, very quickly, research that will lead you to where they were across the pond, as they say, is highly desirable. You hope to get that far. If you don't, if they've been here a long time, consider joining Mayflower Society, perhaps. Oh, I'm sorry. I was trying to rush because I see my time is up. ABT, I'm estimating, okay? So I'm estimating that about, ABT is the standard abbreviation, ABT. You don't put a period after it. And when you put it in Ancestry, it'll read it as about. So you're saying, I don't know for sure, but they're born about. You take any census except the 1900, which asks for a month and a specific year. All the other censuses ask for the age. And most of them were taken in June. So you get their age in June. You have to say, well, they're about, because you don't know, did they already have their birthday? Or is it coming up? Yeah, so ABT, thank you, is for about. And when you think of the family circumstances, don't be too harsh when you find that a man has farmed out three of his young kids, because maybe the wife's not there, or maybe the wife's really sick, and he's got to be out there from sunrise to sundown in the fields just to get enough to eat. And what did he do? She died in August, and he married in September? Did he already know her? No, maybe he did. But the point is, he had to have somebody to take care of their 12 kids that they had to have so that they could run the farm. It really helps you to understand about your people, and they become more real. You also want to consider the history. It's a lot more fun than high school history, I'll tell you that. I'm sorry if there are any high school teachers, history teachers here. I didn't pay attention. But boy, I do now. And you want to consider the extras, the friends that might have been living around them, because if all of a sudden your people disappear, you've been following them, you had them in 1850, in 1860, and they're gone in 1870. How do you find them? Well, if their name is John and Mary Smith, you got a problem. You look for somebody they were associated with or lived by, or maybe a husband of one of the daughters whose name has happened to be Art Hudacek. You go looking for Art. You don't go looking for John Smith when you don't know where John Smith is living. Even when you know where he's living, you don't always go looking for him. And this will help you put together the pieces of your family. And it's time now to start a public family tree on Ancestry. They guarantee privacy, and if they didn't, they'd be out of business tomorrow. I have my 11-year-old granddaughter up on my family tree, and my tree is public, but people who are living, they are blocked. You cannot find out anything about them. You want to plant that tree as soon as you get those first four generations down. You don't want to say, you know what, I don't like this, and I'm just going to pull it off of Ancestry. Don't do that. leave it there for your descendants to find. You want to nourish it. This thing could use a little pruning. I'm not so sure about that branch. Maybe that's where that kid, that funny looking kid came from. And you want to nourish it with extra credit to the person who can give me the next five words on my final slide. I heard document. Go to bed. Oh, guard it. There. Genealogy without documentation is mythology. Thank you very much for your attention. This, right, not the very beginning where I was showing you actually my online tree with my grandmother, but from the time it started warning obsession ahead, that's everything that I have on a flash drive that Liz will have, and all you have to do is bring a flash drive and get it copied off, and you've got the whole thing there, which is why I didn't want you writing a bunch of notes, because I know it's a lot of information to cover in a short amount of time. Yes. Ancestry and Fold 3, which is military records. And bundle it as opposed to buying each one separately, you do get a price break. Ancestry.com owns those other places. Yeah. Oh yes, absolutely. And you can put a tree up on Family Search. Family Search is the site sponsored by the LDS Church, and my only beef with them is that it's not, you put up your tree, and then it's their tree, and other people can come in, and they can change things on your tree about when your grandfather died, or when your great-grandparents were married, and they're supposed to put up why they're changing it. They don't always do that. They're supposed to notify anyone who's interested in this tree that there has been change made. And I'm here to testify, they don't always do that either. But in doing research, I will go there and I'm sure I want to see what other people have said and put together. Family Search, I spend probably a third of my time on Family Search compared to two-thirds most of them. They've got excellent records, outstanding. In fact, I will go from Ancestry. If you're on Ancestry, sometimes the record, you think you're going to see your grandparents' marriage record, and you get there, and it's this little square piece of paper with these little blobs just drawn across it that aren't anything. Go over to Family Search. They've got a wonderful collection of marriage records, and you have to find the exact one. Sometimes it will say you have to search through this film. It's like a film strip, and so you have to go through and kind of graph it with the data. But you love Family Search. Just that's not hard to do. I have a tree there because I want other people to be able to research, but I only took it out to secondary grandparents. Other questions?
So I created part of the family tree. Is that automatically going to make other
she has. It will bring up hints for you, and you can click in, and it will. It'll say, "Okay, here's what's in your tree. Maybe it's blank, or maybe there are some entries and some conflict." And it'll say, "Here's what's in your tree." And you can say, I like this, I don't like this, I like this, I don't like this. Now merge them. You have to physically do it. Nobody else can come into your tree and change it unless you make them an editor on your tree. Be very careful about that. You make somebody an editor on your tree and they can't delete your tree, but they can delete literally every person in it. They can change the dates. I mean, just be very careful when you start giving out permission. I've created this tree in the family, and I know you all want to see it, and so you start sending out all these invitations. That's fine. Make them guests, not editors. And if it's somebody who is living, you can give them. If they aren't living, they're not going to ask you for permission. you can give them permission to see living people, or you can hold that back from them. That's a separate selection. Yes?
In your own will, do you plan to appoint an editor?
I have not thought about that. I should have.
If you were simply not, then you plan.
Well, it would be there. Yeah. They wouldn't be able to change anything, including adding my dad. That's a very good point. That's a very good point. I do know that unfortunately, so I have a lot of clients, and if I create the tree for them, if they didn't create it themselves, it's my tree for life, and I can make them editor. There are a few things they cannot do. Most things they can do that I could do. But it is my tree. So if you get professional help, you want to create the tree yourself and then invite the professional to the tree as an editor. But good question.
I have one story.
Yeah. Southern Way. And you know, give them the brief little talk about the non-standardization of the spelling of names until very recently, and then some families like the Brookshires decided to change it anyway. But I like to always be thinking about the future. I want future generations to find me, to find my clients' trees. And so everything is always documented. And if there is a discrepancy in the spelling of a name, even I finished up one this week. He has Davenports and Devonports. And it's that way in the records, too. And it turns out that they are Devonports from England, from the county of Devon. And over here, they decided they didn't like the sounding of it, too uppity or something. And they changed it to Davenport. So in some lines, you may have multiple spellings. There's a really nice feature on the home page for every individual. I had my grandmother's home page up. For every little block of information that I had there, I have it electronically tied to, in the middle column. Here are the sources. Here's how I know it. You can go right over here to the source. If I have a discrepancy like that, then I would write, you can write in the block. You've got like three lines you can type. And you can say, the surname of this family is also spelled. And then you put in the alternate spellings that you have. But I would definitely learn how. Other questions? Thank you all for coming. And good luck. Oh, yes. So one way to get hints is the classic shaking leaf.
Yeah.
And you follow that up, and when you go to a person, it might have a number on it, like 14. Ooh, I got 14 new hints about this person. Look at all of them. But then over on the right-hand side, there is a list of suggested other records that you should consider looking at. And so you're talking about the second issue, right? This column.
Yes, second issue is what I don't understand. Why these trees come up with, I'm supposed to be in there somewhere, and I'm nowhere.
Well, but you see, it could come from the DNA studies. It could come from names you don't even recognize that you are related to. My husband and I went to Salt Lake 2 weeks ago. And they've got a feature in there. If you've got your tree at Family Search, they give you a little, it looks like a little iPad, and you click it on here, and it'll tell you who else you're related to. Maybe it's been through the library today. And it says that we're 11th cousins. So they can be so far back there that it's not going to be names you know. It's worth looking at the tree to see what is their documentation. And usually it is other